We're going to get started. I'll turn on the camera. So welcome, everyone. Thank you all so much for joining us for today's event. As I mentioned, this is our Your Money, Your Goals frontline staff training. So a little bit about our project, The Learning Community. Basically, its purpose is to help you all build your capacity to fight poverty, and we do that by identifying innovative and promising anti-poverty practice models. And this is of critical importance because anti-poverty work lies at the very center of what we do here in Community Action. As we like to say here at our office, we call it the heart of who we are in Community Action. And in that same sense, we like to begin all of our webinar presentations by reciting the promise of Community Action because it grounds us in our work. And it states that Community Action changes people's lives, embodies the spirit of hope, improves communities, and makes America a better place to live. We care about the entire community, and we are dedicated to helping people help themselves and each other. So specifically about what brings you all here today is this is a part of our national webinar series, and this is really where we kind of showcase our findings on those innovative anti-poverty practice models out to you all in the network. And this event is the first part of our Your Money, Your Goals training week. And hopefully you all have been getting our emails and have seen us on social media talking about the different events that we have that you can participate in this week to facilitate in the spread of this financial empowerment toolkit. So obviously you're here today for our frontline training event, but in addition to that, we also want to encourage you to participate in our Your Money, Your Goals Network Training Day, which will be taking place on November 16th. And that's when we want to hear from you, hopefully that you can get all of the resources that you need from this training to then go out and facilitate other trainings in your organization and across your network, and we want to hear about it. You can participate in that by using the hashtag YMYGCAP. Send us your pictures, comments, you know, insights, thoughts across social media. We're on pretty much every platform, so you can reach us there. And without further ado, I'm going to turn things over to our presenter and facilitator today, Denise Devon. So Denise, you're on. Go ahead.
Hello, Hyacinth. Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you great.
Oh, good. Hello, Community Action. Welcome to each and every one of you, and I think that we have most of the people on the phone today are those of you who work directly with consumers. Some of you on the phone today are managers and directors, and some of you are trainer types. And I am so delighted to be with you today. I'm in the great state of Minnesota, believe it or not, and I work with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and have been now. I'm in my sixth year, and I had the privilege of being on the team that developed the Your Money, Your Goals toolkit coming out of the asset building field. And I used to be working with Community Action years ago, and I was a national trainer for the National Association of Community Action Agencies, and I also was really involved in the Minnesota State Association as the executive director. So I know the CAPS, and I want to ask you to think about something, and I want to thank you, Hyacinth. I want to thank Tiffany. I want to thank Denise, your executive director nationally, and your entire team for the enormous work that you have done to help bring this toolkit to community action agencies and community action programs, the Community Action Partnership throughout the country. You know, thousands and thousands and thousands of people have been trained in this toolkit, all 50 states and Puerto Rico. And so many are using parts of it, more parts of it, or all of it in their direct work. This toolkit is not meant in any way to replace the good tools or worksheets or curriculum or financial capability or financial coaching methods and resources that you've got. This is meant to be a value add, to fill in the quiver, maybe some holes and materials that you don't have. And let me just give you kind of an idea here for a minute. Your entire network was part of a huge rollout. About 2,000 people in your network were trained a few years ago. And to the leadership, because of the leadership nationally and the leadership locally, you guys are part of another rollout, and many of your local agencies kind of signed up to be part of this 2017 cohort. All that means is that you join the USDA Cooperative Extension System, the United Way System, the Catholic Charities USA System, legal services throughout the country, not just legal services, but community volunteers, the unions, the AFL-CIO unions. It goes on and on and on of the numbers of people. I just got done working with the great state of Pennsylvania and their correctional system, the DC TANF system, the New York City Children's Department, the Los Angeles County. I mean, example upon example upon example of government agencies, not-for-profits, collaboratives, networks, coalitions in every field, people working in AIDS, people working in housing, people working in homeless, people working in workforce systems, people working in mental health systems, the foster care system in two different states, the TANF systems in three different states. So know that people are really using this set of tools and resources, and they're beginning to really integrate this work into the normal everyday business of helping people get out of poverty, of helping people make ends meet, of helping people getting to financial stability as a first step to financial security. And it doesn't matter what the program is. It doesn't matter if it's weatherization, energy assistance, or Head Start. I should tell you that Head Start parents in Orange County, 1,500 Head Start parents have got all of this as part of their action plan and their financial, not their financial, their advocates that meet with them in centers have got this going on in direct work with them for 2 years while they're in the Head Start program. So there's a whole bunch of examples in the country that touch the CAP world that aren't part of the CAP world. I want you to know a couple of other things before we get started. This is going to be a very interactive session, and Hyacinth, I'm just going to ask you if you could please give me the permission to move the slides because, oh, there it is right there. This is going to be a very interactive. I got it, Hyacinth. I'm so grateful to work with you because you're so much smarter than I am about this stuff. This disclaimer, these slides are all available to you. You can use any of this or none of it locally. Of course, we want you to use it. We're grateful that there's a Your Money, Your Goals week, that people are focusing on it. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But know that whenever you use this information, there's a disclaimer that goes with it, and the disclaimer says you're not in trouble. You're not giving any kind of financial advice. You're not giving any kind of investment advice. These are simply education materials. The CFPB isn't in any trouble. There's no legal interpretation here. I'm an educator. I'm not a financial investor, any of that kind of stuff. No money's being made. All of this is free, tax dollars at work, et cetera. So just know that if you use it, you want to have the disclaimer with it. This is what the toolkit looks like. Today, over almost 21,000 have been trained, but those are just the ones we've counted in the various rollout cohorts. There are many, many, many more that have been trained and are using the toolkit. One of the CAP agencies in Knoxville trained everybody. They trained bus people on the driving the bus. They trained food service workers. They trained Head Start. They trained weatherization. They trained housing. They trained all 500 staff, all 500, not in every tool and not in every topic. So people are doing whole systems by taking this and really using it. In Portland, Oregon, they started out in a, not a CAP agency, but they started out in an asset building group, And that group grew, and now they've got learning communities of people who have been trained to get together to sharpen the saw about how to actually use it as financial coaches, financial capability experts, et cetera. One of your CAP agents has been invited by its local city to go in and train all the city staff that the CAP agency has built its knowledge and chutzpah and capability, and now the city is asking them as the go-to to go in, and it's likely that dollars help to pay for all that. So I'm aware that in many, many states, this work has been going on for years and years and years and years. For others, it's still brand new, and that's okay too, all right? Now, the other thing I want to just point out is that next to the toolkit that you are going to have access to use, there are a lot of companion resources. For example, we just created, the CFPB just created, a whole focus on reentry, people coming out of prison and incarceration, and all the issues that go around that. What does it mean to get your driver's license, your social security number, any kind of identity? What does it mean when you've got debt that's consumer debt and restitution debt? And if you don't do the restitution debt first, you can land back. What does it mean to do planning? What happens when people walk out and they have absolutely no cash whatsoever and they're on public benefits and they've got child support in arrears? All right, then there's another guide for Native communities. And I just did a wonderful training in Albuquerque with Navajo leaders and their communities. And there's a whole thing in there on elder financial abuse, on values. You know, how do we manage our money and spend our money according to our values? If you value your elders living with you, how does that affect the bottom line and cash flow? We have another huge guide that's just come out hot off the press on disabilities, helping people with assisted devices, helping people with their ABLE accounts, IDA accounts, and on it goes. So just know that even though we're going to focus on your money or goals, all this other stuff is available to you. It's free, and we can't say enough about how much we want you to use it, all right? I want to just ask those of you on the phone, and if you can use the question and answer at the bottom here, and Hyacinth, just to let you know I'm having trouble with it, but is there anybody who could just let us know? We've got 155 people on the line, which is amazing throughout this country. How many of you are already using your money, your goals? Could you just let us know, are you already using it? And I want to be able to see what we get here. And Hyacinth, if you could help me be able to see this in my chat function.
Sure. So if everyone can send that through the chat box, and please make sure to select all panelists from the drop-down menu. That way both of us can see it.
Beautiful. So if you guys can let me know, yes, we're using this, Courtney says. We've got some people who are already using it. Yes, parts of it, Stephanie says. Okay. Julie says we're just starting to use it. Good. Lisa said not quite yet. Not yet, Tracy says. All right, so we've got a real mixture. All right, so please bear with me because this opening activity is really important. So I want you to use the chat function if you would, and I want you to answer this question. Could you list all the words and phrases and sayings and songs or any association you have with the word money? Money is such a loaded topic, like politics, like other topics that are forbidden to talk about in public space. Money. Anne says rich, poor. Any association, money is the root of all evil. Keep going, guys. Show me the money, freedom, loaded. Money, 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 the song. Thank you, Stephanie. Money makes the world go round, all about the money, all about the Benjamins. Thank you, Lauren. Anybody else? Money is the root of all evil, balanced budgets, no money, 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 bills, 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 stress, safe. I want to be safe. Okay, so you guys are doing a great job. So the reason I'm asking this, money is power. Okay, so I want you to think about this. You have a lot of definitions that have to do with emotion. You have definitions that are hardcore accounting. You've got definitions that have bias in them, which is what we hear in the culture, right? Here's a definition of money. So I want you just to bear with me for a second, and it's really boring. Money, any generally accepted medium of exchange. Could be goats, could be grain, could be coin, could be paper, could be bartering. Any generally accepted medium of exchange. We think of money as paper for sure, but when you think about goods and services and different parts of the world and how we exchange, it's really pretty boring. I give you this if you give me that, right? Very, very, very boring. So the question I want to ask you guys is, where do our associations come from? Where do our associations come from? Where do our associations come from? Okay, they come from parents and caregivers. They come from the TV and parents and media and community and the region and religion. Thank you. They come from school. They come from childhood. They come from the life of hard knocks. They come from culture, right? All right, they come from our experience of what works and what doesn't work. They come from the hard knocks in life. They come from the media. All right, now, here's the question I want you to think about. I want you to think about the last question. Whatever we learned about money, I want you to think about where you are parked right now. I'm going to ask you some questions. Are you a spender or are you a saver? If you're married, are you married to a spender or a saver or partnered? What are your values around keeping money, sharing money, or both? When it comes to gender, are there any differences between men and women around money or between rural and urban around money? Are there any differences that come up? You mentioned religion. Are there any spiritual values that come up around how money is to be used? So I want you to help me out here for a minute because this is tithing. Thanks. Some religions expect and encourage tithing. What about culture? How is money managed or used or shared in different cultures? If you've worked with anybody from the Latino or Latina culture, how is money shared? What happens in Latino culture that's very common? What happens? Or Native American, American Indian culture? So I have a lot of Latino people in my life, which is amazing. Yeah, some of the cultures believe they have to take care of the whole family, and it's a gift to do that. Others believe they take care of their own. Some believe that in tithing, you give the first 10% away even if you don't have any food in the house. Others believe you always give to yourself first, always, and then if there's something left over. People who survived World War II or the Great Depression may handle money a little differently than, let's say, a millennial might. How would you notice that difference there? So I want you to think about there are vast differences. Money is, oh, that's interesting. Money is like manure, this person says, and you spread it around. That you've heard that. Okay. So I want you to think about you. I want you to think about where you're parked. First thing I want you to think about are your values. What is important to you in how money is handled? Just do a little come to conversation with yourself. Think about you and money for a minute. How do you handle money? Are you somebody who checks it every day and shares it the degree to which you can? Are you somebody who checks it every day and keeps it? Are you someone who doesn't check it every day and it just all works out? Are you someone who would give the coat off your back even if you didn't have a coat? We're talking about values. Do you have a spiritual tradition that's expected that money is shared? Do you have a coming of age celebration that happens in your own religious background that costs money? Do you have cultural events that are expected that you would go to, like a powwow, where you'd need your dance and regalia so that you could participate? Are you expected to pay the funeral costs or to help share in the funeral costs if someone dies and there's no money to bury them? I want you to think about your culture. I want you to think about what you brought with you into this world. Are you Irish and German or Dutch or Scandinavian? Are you South African? Are you Indian? Are you Indian? Are you, you know, where do you come from? And how was money taught to you? What was expected of you around money? So you think of your values, you think of your culture, and you think of your emotions. Let's think of emotions for a minute. Have you ever spent money you didn't have because it was an emotional decision to do so? Okay, so some people are writing, I was never taught anything about money and I'm learning it for the first time. Others of you say, yeah, I've spent money I haven't had because it was expected. Have any of you ever bought for your children Jordan shoes when you knew there wasn't enough to do that and it was an emotional decision? Or you bought things at Christmas or Hanukkah or at the end of Ramadan when there weren't enough resources? Or you decided to buy this house over that when you knew you were stretched a little bit more? Of course we have, all of us have. So I want you to think about where you're parked, and I want you to be very kind to yourselves, because wherever you're parked, you're parked. Whatever you learned, you learned. And the thing I want you to think about is, what did I learn about money as a child or a young person or a young adult that I want to pass on? What did I learn about money that I want to pass on? I can't seem to get this going for some reason, and maybe I'm writing in the wrong place. So what did I learn about money that I want to pass on? And what did I learn about money that I don't want to pass on? Okay, I learned to pay my bills on time. Keep going, guys. I learned how to save and to manage it. Okay, Larry, thank you for that. You never know what tomorrow holds, so be prepared for today. Okay, all right? So I want you to think about this. Whatever you learned about money that you want to pass on, make a list. Don't blow it all at once. What you learned about money, or what I learned about money as a child that I don't want to pass on, I want to also make a list. All right, so as we think about money, you and I are sitting across the table and we're partnering with others. Okay, I want to maintain my savings. Thank you, Michelle. All right, so we partner with people around money. And when we partner with people around money, Hyacinth, isn't this robust? When we partner with people around money, they will sometimes be parked in a different place than I am or you are. What can come up when we work with people around money? And it starts with a J. What can come up? What can come up when we're working with people? Jealousy, judgment. You guys got it. You nailed it. And when we have judgment or jealousy that comes up, then what? Does it keep the conversation going or does it close it down? Well, in most instances, it shuts down. And if you and I are charged with partnering with people around changing money to move from where we are today to where we want to be tomorrow, to move from homelessness to financial stability, or to move from an entry-level job to a better-paying job, or to move from dissolution in a partnership in a marriage and the loss of income toward gaining income, or whatever happens for, or cancer situations, or all the things that happen in life, we want to be judgment-free. Therefore, we want to really be on top of our jealousies and our judgments. I've used this example before in training your colleagues, but there was an amazing woman, I just loved her, in Washington, and she admitted out loud how upset she was that the woman she was working with could do pedicures and manicures and she couldn't, because she didn't make enough money to do pedicures and manicures, right? But when she went underneath it, what's really going on here, she found out that that mother wanted to be just like every other middle-class mom at the parent-teacher conference. That it was an emotional decision when there was no food in the house to spend her meager earnings on pedicures and manicures so that she could fit in, so that her children could fit in, so that the children had the same kind of clothes and wouldn't be laughed at. Now that was a decision once she went underneath. I had another colleague of mine could not believe that runaway and homeless youth would buy a phone, expensive phone, and a cell phone with a data plan when they had no place to sleep. And when they went underneath it, what do you think she found? That those young people wanted to fit in. So what I'm driving here is that this first topic on money for any of us is to go to a judgment-free place and to try to get underneath the money decisions that are made, even if they're different than our priorities, because a lot of those money decisions are based on their values, they're based on their culture, they're based on their beliefs, and they're based on emotion. Right or wrong, that's where they are today. And you and I need to figure out ways to bring it up in such a way so that people think about today and they think about tomorrow. Today and tomorrow. Today and tomorrow. Okay? All right. Now, this training is going to do an overview of the toolkit, and you're going to be able to see what's here that you can use, pick up what fits, leave the rest. And by the end of the training, your knowledge will have increased, and I'm going to skip over all of this, and we're going to go right away into the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. So Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Consumer is anybody. It doesn't have to be a citizen. Financial, it's about money. Protection, it's about protecting it, and Bureau is a federal agency. And they were created about 6 years ago, and they have your back. They're trying to make everything work in the marketplace and trying to really do it through empowerment, enforcement, and education. And so far, they've given back about $12 billion to consumers from banks and credit card companies, et cetera, who haven't followed the rules or the law. That's their enforcement arm. They empower people, they hope, by creating stuff like this. Toolkits and resources and training and support and et cetera. And they educate people in the way that we're doing now. They work with millions of low and moderate income people, but they do it through people like you. So after today, you become an ambassador for them because they can't reach the millions of people that there are out there. And you can go to their website at consumerfinance.gov, and on the right-hand side, put in your email address. And if there's something that comes out on our prepaid debit card, or there's a financial abuse, or there's a new tool on how to buy a home, you wouldn't believe the stuff on their website. You'll be able to hear it firsthand, and they want to connect you directly. On the website, you can get the toolkit, you can get behind on bills, and you can get all these companion guides for free. You can also tell your story. This was a Head Start mom in Detroit. This woman got threatened by a debt collector. The debt collector said that they were going to put her in jail. That is against the law. They were reported. Intervention was done. This woman got to be able to pull her life back together and get the debt collector off her back. So there's a way you can tell your story, and you guys in the CAP world are advocates. They believe that financial empowerment is really different. It's knowing literacy, but it's also having the skills and the confidence to do something about it. So it's one thing for me to know that my credit report is my financial resume. It's another thing to have the guts to pull it, look at it without freezing, and fix it. It's one thing to know that cash flow every week is critical. It's another thing to actually use a calendar and do it. So that we're going for empowerment here, not just learning. A lot of people in the early days of the asset building field, and I was in Minnesota, you know, working through our CAP system and the tribes and all kinds of groups. And we did financial education. It was good. It was all good. But it was knowledge only. And that knowledge can go in one ear and out the other. What we're trying to do, and you guys know this because you're doing it, we want to get to financial capability, financial empowerment, so that people actually have confidence. And you are the trusted other. I told the CAP Network in June, when we first started building the toolkit, we did a scan in the country and we interviewed Head Start teachers and Head Start parents as part of the scan. And in one community, the Head Start parent went to the Head Start teacher and said, I just saw something on the internet that I could make more money on the weekends if I do this home business. Is it safe? And the Head Start teacher said, I don't know. What would I know, right? That Head Start parent never went to the parish priest, the rabbi, the banker, anybody in town. That Head Start parent went to the Head Start teacher. The other thing that happened in another state on the East Coast is that a bunch of the family advocates got trained in this stuff, not this one, but a similar set of financial literacy topics. They were so excited, they went in to do their home visiting and they froze because they didn't know how to bring up the topic on money. They knew how to talk about kids. They knew how to, what it talked about getting ready for school. They knew what it meant to get out of poverty, to get safe homes, but they didn't know how to talk about money. So the trusted other is you, and that's what they believe. And this is an exercise you could do in your agency. It's kind of a debate. You divide up the room, and one side of the room said, this is why we should learn about this stuff and integrate it in. And the other side of the room, this is why we shouldn't learn about this stuff. And if we don't have time to do this now, but you could do it. And if you do this exercise, the reason we want to learn about this stuff is it helps to improve program outcomes and individual family outcomes to get from where they are to more financial stability. The reason we don't want to do it is that we have too much to do. We're not paid to do it, et cetera. But by the time this debate is done, all the arguments are out, and most people land on, yeah, we need to learn this stuff and integrate it in. Now, the toolkit is broken down into a couple of different ways. There's an introductory, and then there's content. This introduction to the toolkit has got what we call a financial empowerment checklist, and some of you will use this. The checklist is about 3 or 4 pages, and let's say you're working with Jeremy and a Jeremiah and a Jareen and you know, somebody else, right? You would write down all the topics you're working on with them, him or her, and then track it from one time to the next. And that's the financial empowerment checklist. The financial empowerment self-assessment, we encourage everybody to take in the country, everybody. And it's got a lot, and you do it, you don't share the answers with anybody because it's private, but all the staff get to see where they are in their money lives and where they could go in the toolkit to learn more. For example, goals are not important to financial planning or budgets. I must have 3 to 6 months worth of living expenses. A cash flow budget helps me track if I've got enough cash to cover my bills. If you can't pay all your bills, you must pay the squeaky wheel first, the debt collector. The only way to get employment is through a paycheck. Credit is when you owe somebody money. So there's those kinds of questions. Then there's other questions that you could use as an assessment with people you work with. I have money set aside for emergencies and goals. I know how to claim tax credits. I'm not worried about the money I owe. I'm confident about the information in my credit report. Now, the staff would do it for themselves, but they could also just ask these questions of the consumer. Then the third set of questions is, I have a savings and a checking account. I've applied for and received a credit card. I've gone to a pawn shop. I've gone to a check cashing place. And then it shows for every single answer what the right answer is, and it shows where to go in the toolkit. And so I can't say enough about this. My Money Picture is a different kind of financial assessment, and you could do this with your consumers, your clients, the guests who come to your programs, and it's called My Money Picture. And I love the first question. Do you have dreams? Do you have dreams for yourself or your children that require money? Are you behind on your rent, your utility payments? Can you count on about the same amount of money every month or every week or every 2 weeks? When the unexpected comes, is there anything set aside? Do you have any student loans or debts you're having trouble paying? Is your credit history making it hard to open up a checking account or to buy a car or to get a rental place or to get insurance or even a job? So it goes on like that, and a lot of people will just use the assessment and they'll just talk it through. They won't have anybody fill it out because it's really overwhelming. And then there's all kinds of ideas for every question about what you could do with your clients. Do you have dreams for yourself? Well, you would brainstorm a list of their hopes, their wants, their dreams. I shared with your colleagues in June that there was a beautiful, amazing African-American woman in Georgia, and she said, I just want my children to have a better life than I've ever had. But when we broke it down, you know, she was going to make sure her children, her son in particular, was going to get a welding certificate so that he could get a job, right? So that's the beginning part of the toolkit. Then you get to this other part, which is the content modules. And it starts with setting goals, micro goals, savings for emergencies, irregular bills and short-term goals, tracking what comes in, tracking what goes out, putting it all together through the month. And when we say tools, we mean worksheets. These are all worksheets that you can actually use with your consumers. You won't use all of them. You'll use some of them, or maybe you'll use all of them. Depends what your programs are. And then we get into debt and credit and money services and protecting your money. So if you look at the big picture, goal setting, planning for life events like cancer comes, like children move home, like the loss of a job, like an early funeral, life events that happen, childbirth, you know, insurance doesn't cover all that stuff, buying a car. The savings is how do I save? What about asset limits? How do I find a safe place to save? How do I use the tax credits to increase my savings? And then finally, income and resource. What are all the resources that come in? Ways to receive income and benefits, especially if I don't bank, ways to increase my income legally and my resources. And then on the spending side, where does my money go? Where are the spending leaks? Could I use a calendar? How do I pay my bills if I don't bank? What are some strategies to cut expenses and combine bills? When cash is short, how do I prioritize? And then finally, on cash flow, what comes in the beginning, what goes out every week, how do I use a chart, how do I use a calendar, how do I improve my checklist, my cash flow checklist. On the debt, the first thing we do is we track it, we see if our debt to income ratio is too high, we look at the guidelines, we reduce the debt to the snowball method or the higher interest rate method. We repay student loans. There's a whole bunch of ways to do that now. And what do we do when debt collectors call? And then finally on credit, how do we pull a credit report safely? How do we look at it and not freeze? How do we fix it? No audio at this time. Hyacinth, can you help here?
Yes, I'm working on it. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. How do we keep records? A lot of people who are in crisis don't keep their financial records, and we've got a whole checklist on that. Finally, we get to money services. You know, what do we need around money services? And then what are our options? And what are the pros and cons and the advantages and disadvantages? And then finally, money basics. What do you have to open an account? Do you have to have a Social Security number? The answer is no. What about money transfers? All the people sending money abroad, what are the new rules around that? And finally, in submitting a complaint, how do we do that? What happens to the complaints? How do they get resolved? How do we protect our identity on the front end before it happens? And what do we do on the back end when it happens? And how do we listen to the red flags inside around all the promises, the free lunches, the this or the that? And then finally, all the consumer laws, they're all in one place. So that's the big toolkit, right? Think of it as a primer. The other thing we want you to think about is to create a referral guide, because you are not expected to deal with bankruptcies or evictions, probably, unless that's part of your work, foreclosures, consolidating loans, children's college. You're not expected to handle that. So we've got a referral guide for you that you can put in your zip code. And if you have just these five referrals, your legal aid attorney, the banks and credit unions that will do second chance checking and savings accounts, your credit and debt counselor who's trained and isn't going to expect any money in return, those are the main, well, and also your free tax sites and how to bring in the earned income tax credit. If you have those referrals at the ready, that's a good thing. That's, we really encourage that. All right. Now, this is what the financial empowerment checklist looks like. So you could have this for any of your clients, and you would make notes on what they've done. You could put it in your system, whatever you use. The money conversation is really, really, really important. This is the self-assessment that we did in the beginning. The question is, how do we use this? Like I've already read through the questions on My Money Picture. This is all the assessment in the beginning, because after the assessment is done, then we get into goal setting. And when we get into goal setting, you and I know how important it is to be specific and measurable, et cetera. So let's say somebody wants to buy a television, and it's going to cost $400. Or let's say they want to get out of credit card debt and it's going to cost $1,000, but they want to get it paid off over 18 months. These are goals. That's a strong goal. I want to buy a television, weak goal, but I'm going to save $400 over 6 months to get the television. That's a strong goal. I want to get out of credit card debt, not so strong, but I'm going to knock down $1,000 in 18 months. Pretty strong, right? Pretty clear. I've got holidays coming up, right? At the end, I need $300 for the holidays. I've got 12 weeks left. Oh boy, let's see now. We don't have 12 weeks left anymore before the holidays. But let's say I get paid every week. I've got to set aside $25 a week. So you can take this tool and break it down. If somebody gets paid twice a month or every other week or once a month or seasonally or whatever it is, you take this tool and break it down. The other thing we want you to think about is that there's a lot of costs in life that none of us plan on. Childbirth costs, breast cancer, or prostate cancer, or brain cancer, or any of the healthcare things that come up. A coming of age celebration, a funeral. And then look at this, for example. Here's an 18-year-old graduating from high school and wants to go to trade school to become a welder. What are the money issues involved in that? Here's a 28-year-old food services worker at a state university, all of a sudden gets cancer and is married and has an infant. What are the money issues that goes with that? A 36-year-old mom is getting divorced, two kids under eight, got to find a job again for the first time in 9 years, used to be a math teacher. What are the money issues involved in that? A 45-year-old guy is downsized from a manufacturing job, married with one kid, is 15 years old, and the child plans to go to college out of state. Money issues involved. And a 56-year-old truck driver wants to retire in 6 years, saved minimally for retirement. Children are grown, out of school, out of house. But then somebody lost the job, and they plan to return home with two preschool children. So when you think of the money issues involved in this, this has to do with goal setting. It has to do with savings. And our people may not be in a position to save a lot right now, but we're going to talk about that in a minute. But in the first instance, it's kind of the money issues are finding the Pell Grants, right, and all the grants that are available. And the food services worker has got to have something set aside for loss of income when getting treatment. you know, and the mom has got to figure out how to pay for some schooling to build her skills so she could teach again. And the 45-year-old guy, the child's going to go to school, well, it's learning about school loans and not to take out too much and not too little and how to pay it back and all that stuff. And the truck driver, you know, he can make ends meet, but not when three more people move home, extra heat, extra food, extra lights, you know, all that stuff that happens in life. So these are important to think about. So there's a tool in here that helps people plan for life events and just has people think about what's coming up in the next year, 2 years, 3 years. There's also a tool for how to buy a car. I think it's good. Some people think it's not enough. But, you know, how do you negotiate contracts? How do you negotiate a loan? What happens if your credit score is not so high? How do you be really, really careful of not getting set up for a car title loan? That's the kind of loan in some states where you borrow against what is the value of the car, and it's really hard to pay those off, you know? So anyway, that's that. So now we're going to get into savings. And I want to ask you guys a question. And I want you to use the chat function. If I asked you what savings is, I know you're going to say to me, savings is money that I actually set aside today for use tomorrow. I actually set it aside. It's not money that I don't spend and give away. It's money that I actually set aside. And so I want to ask you this question. Can you use the chat function? Now I can see it. Can you use a chat function, and can you list all the emergencies that come up under $500? All the emergencies that come up under $500. New tires, utilities, auto repairs, car repairs, battery, rent, appliances, sick children, water heater, food, home repairs, home vets, vet bills, doc bills, broken appliances, a tooth that needs pulling, health issues, medical bills, loaning family money. Oh, yeah, I know that one. Just school supplies, glasses, tires, roof repair. Okay? Good job, everybody. Now I'm going to ask you a really hard question. Of all the things that were mentioned, which of these are irregular bills and not emergencies? Which ones of these are irregular bills? In other words, they come up sometime during the year, maybe more than once, but they're not really emergencies. We know they're going to come. Okay, so the repair and maintenance on some vehicles, some of the dental, some of the medical, the property taxes, the car maintenance. Yep, school lunch bills, utility gifts, holidays, yep. Some of the home repairs, yep. The homeowner's insurance, yep. School supplies, yep. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to build a house. Pretend that we're building a house. Pretend you live somewhere that has a basement. So there's a basement, the first floor, the second floor, and then the whole house. So the thing I want to drive home is that we need savings. We need savings for emergencies. We need savings for irregular bills. You know, the irregular bills become emergencies if we don't save for it. Irregular bills. We need savings for short-term goals, like going on vacation, really short-term goals. And we need savings for longer-term goals. So when we get to cash flow, there should be four lines of savings: emergencies, irregular bills, short-term goals, longer-term goals, right? And when we say emergencies, we're talking $500 or less. And when we use the money for emergencies, our job every pay period is to replace it, because there's always an emergency, or an emergency is going to come. The irregular bills is really important, as you know, and I know, because they, like September always happens, the kids always have to go back to school in September. Summer always comes. There's no free reduced lunch or breakfast in the summertime, right? Christmas always comes. Hanukkah always comes. The birthday always comes. The wedding doesn't always come. The prom doesn't always come. The funeral doesn't always come. Those are shorter term goals. I'm going to get married. I'm going to the prom, right? So Diane says, fires, homeowners insurance, non-emergency bills, taxes, school supplies, holidays, those are irregular bills. Some banks have got a savings account you can open for the holidays, and you set something aside automatically. A lot of banks don't, of course, but I want you to think about savings for irregular bills, and you add them up. You and I add them up for the year. And then we set money aside for those. Some of us are going to use the earned income tax credit when it comes once a year to cover the irregular bills. There's nothing wrong with that. But savings for emergencies, 500 or less, savings for irregular bills, savings for short-term goals. I got to replace the car. Oh, crap. Yep, I can take out a huge loan, and I will. But if I can pay down some of it, you know, and I know a lot of people in my life, they had to learn how to do this. They have to replace a car every 4 or 5 years. So they make the payments on the first car, but then they keep making that payment in a savings account. So they've got the cash ready for the next car. And the same is true at holiday time. If they get used to setting $10 aside every pay period, it gets set up for the next year. Or that's also the birthday fund, et cetera. So I want you to think about emergencies for irregular bills, savings for short-term goals, like a car, or going on vacation, even a camping trip. And then I want you to think about savings for longer-term goals, and that could be like retirement or going to school or something else, or a big prom or a big wedding that you know is going to come. It's just a matter of time, right? All right, so that's that. Now, the other thing I wanted to show you is that what we're trying to drive away here, and you could show this to your consumers, is that here's an example of somebody who has an auto repair of $350. I'm going to assume this is like a car crash, that this is not really just changing the oil on the car. It would never cost that much. It could be batteries. You know, I'm not sure what it is. But the bottom line is, if somebody's got $350 on the left-hand side, it's only going to cost them $350. If they put it on a credit card in the middle column, and let's say it's at 16%, and they've got to pay a monthly payment of $25, they're paying an extra $40 over 16 months in interest. Therefore, the whole thing is going to cost them $390. Is it bad to put it on a credit card? No. It's not bad. It's not good. It just is. But it costs more. What if somebody goes to a payday loan, a payday lender, they get the $350 loan, they've got to pay $15 for every $100 borrowed in the two-week period. That's 400% APR. They've got to pay back the loan plus the fee of $52 within the 2 weeks. If they don't do that, they have to pay $52.50 for every 2 weeks. So in this example, they pay an extra $402. I'm sorry, they pay $402 for a $350 bill. Is it bad to use a payday loan? No. It's not bad. It's not good. It just is. It costs more. So what we're trying to drive at is if somebody can cobble together emergency savings, then they use their emergency savings and not all these extra costs. Sometimes people have to do the extra costs because that's what they have to do. But we use this as a teaching tool, and a lot of people are using this with the clients so that the clients can say, oh, crap, I don't think I want to go down this road. One research study done by the CFPB, people turned over their payday loans only every they couldn't pay it off for 7 two-week periods of time, seven, before they could pay it all off. And the fees that added up were just unbelievable. Now, I want to say something else about interest rates and credit scores. If somebody's got a 16% interest rate, do you think they have a good credit score an average credit score or a poor credit score? What do you think? If they're paying 16%, do they have a good credit score? Nancy says a poor. Rob says average. Poor, average, average. All right. So a good credit score is 700 and above. An average credit score is 650-ish to 700. A poor credit score is below 600, 650. Now, somebody that's got a 16% APR, I want you to think of a teeter-totter. Maybe when you were a kid, you were on a teeter-totter. You know, if you sit down, the other person goes up, and if they sit down, you go up. So this is how it works. If you and I have a high credit score, meaning 700 or above, we go high, and the opposite goes low. That means the interest rate is the low end. If you and I have a really poor credit score and we sit down, our credit score is low and the interest rate on everything is high. So during the housing crisis, a lot of people bought homes with poor credit scores and they were paying inordinate amounts of interest on their payments. Same is true with credit cards. Some people are at 29%. Interest rate or at 9%. A 9% interest rate on a credit card is really pretty darn good. They've got a high credit score. A 16% is average. A 29%, they've got a low credit score. So when you're working with somebody and they've got really high interest rates, the first thing you probably know is that their credit scores are really low. But a lot of people will improve their credit scores and they've never gotten the better interest rates. So I want to point that out for a minute. And so here's the tool. Let's say $1,000 into an emergency reserve is going to be done over 10 months. That's a good goal, right? Now, I need $1,000. I'm going to do it in 10 months. That means I'm going to put $100 a month in if I get paid once, $50 if I get paid twice, $50 if I get paid every other week. You know, you break it down, and then you say, what's the strategy for how I'm going to find this money? Well, if I cut back on basic cable, I can save $40. If I cut back to one fast food meal instead of, you know, every day, I've already got my $100. So the idea is to really help people get to this. Some people will, I know a lot of Native Americans, they'll do something in common, and they'll create together the savings because they are making money in common and they divvy it out. And some people do that. That's great. There's another tool in here on assets. And some people are really afraid to save because they're afraid they're going to lose all their assets. And you need to look in your state about what your asset limits are. A lot of the SNAP asset limits have been removed, so there are no asset limits. TANF might have an asset limit, but if somebody puts $250 away in cash, it's probably not going to mess with their asset limit. But we can't say it's up to every state and every community to kind of look at this and reassure people about it. And then this tool helps people find a safe place for savings. What are the benefits and risks to keeping it at home or on your body or under the mattress or in a savings account or with a friend, etc.? And have people kind of really think through it. So the tool looks like this, and it goes through all the pros and the cons, okay? All right. Now, this is the Earned Income Tax Credit, and I know that you're the CAPS, Community Action Partnerships, Community Action Agencies, Community Action Programs. You know about this, but not everybody does. So last year's numbers on the Earned Income Tax Credit, and again, millions and millions of dollars sits at the Treasury. It never goes out to the states because people don't claim it. But if you look at the right-hand side, somebody could file their taxes with no children and get up to $500 if their individual income is below $14,000 or their combined income, if they file jointly, is under $20,000. The individuals don't get as much because this is kind of built for families and households. If somebody files their taxes with one qualifying child, if you look to the right, they can get up to $3,400 if their income is below $39,000 alone or $44,000 together, if they have two children, $5,600, three children or more, $6,300. And you guys know that in your states, if your state has an earned income tax credit, which is usually a portion of the federal, they get more cash than this. And the moral of this story is use some of it to seed savings for emergencies, savings for irregular bills, savings for short-term goals, and reducing unwanted debt, like credit card debt. Now, one of the things you should know is that there's been a lot of scams, and so there's extra verification that's gone on and is going on to really prove that somebody is who they are on the earned income tax credit claims and on the children's tax credit. Thereby, some of the consumers are used to getting their money back in January, and it might not be coming back until April or later. So just know that. Now, we're going to go to a cluster of topics that go together. One is to track what comes in, the other is to track what goes out, and then to put it all together into cash flow. And I'm going to go through this not too fast, not too slow, but a lot of people do not know. They do not understand how their money comes in. I'm always surprised by this, and then I'm not surprised. So do I have a regular job, and is my income regular? Is my net regular? Is it something I can count on twice a month, every other week, once a month, once a week? Or do I have a regular job but irregular income? Or do I have a small business and that's always irregular, right? I might work at McDonald's 40 hours this week, 20 hours the next, 30 hours the next, and I get sick and I don't work any hours the last week. I don't get paid. So the idea here is we want people to understand when their income comes in and how much comes in and what their net is. And if they get paid every Friday, is it regular? Is it something they can count on or not? Seasonal work, you and I know, is the kind of work that just comes seasonally. A lot of farmers, they have seasonal work. Construction workers, seasonal work. People who work at the holiday time, seasonal work. People who work for state fairs, seasonal work. I have a lot of Native Americans in my life. They rice in the fall. They're farmers, seasonal work. I have a lot of people in my life, and you do too, who will have a regular job, and they've got a second job on the side, and it's still regular. Every Friday they go and they do something, some security thing in a hospital. Or it's seasonal. They have this extra thing they do, and they bring it in, shoveling snow, cutting grass, selling vegetables, whatever it is. The one-time occurrence are things like a loan. Or it could be a tax return, something like that. Child support should be regular. It's sometimes irregular. It's sometimes seasonal, and it's sometimes one time in a year. And, of course, child support is one of those, you know, really touchy subjects. But child support is a source of income, so is alimony. We need to know about benefits, too. They need to know, is it SSI I'm getting? Is it SSDI? Is it Medicare? Yeah, Medicare. Is it veterans benefits? Is it TANF? Is it SNAP, food assistance? Is it a child care voucher? Is it a housing voucher? What am I getting? And do I have both income and a benefit? So I need to know what I've got coming in. I need to know about wage garnishments. If I haven't paid my child support or my school loans, if I've not paid my past taxes, my wages will be garnished. It's a matter of time before it all catches up. And there is no free lunch, ever. Very few people have free lunch passed from one generation to the next, meaning they don't have to work, right? Now, this is a tracker, and this fits into a larger tool later on in cash flow. And some people love it because they think in charts. Other people hate it because they're more visual and more artistic. But bear with me on the chart business, and I want you to look at the topics here. On the top across week one, week two, week three, week four, and there should be a week five with a total. because we have 3 months of the year have 5 weeks in them, right? So I'll use myself as an example. I'm lucky I have a paycheck. I get paid every other week. In November, I'm getting paid the second and the fourth week. I would put in my net on the second and the fourth week. On the first and the third week, it would say zero. And you would do the same if you get paid the second. I think a lot of people do get paid the second, you know, get paid every other week. So that's November, but December, I might get paid the first and the third week, right? And then in January, I might get paid the first, third, and fifth week, if there's 3 weeks. I don't know if there is or not, I haven't looked it up. So then on the left-hand side, we've got a job, a second job, self-employment, SNAP, TANF, SSI, SSDI, veterans benefits, the earned income tax credit, a loan. It goes on and on and on in the real tool. And then the frequency is it regular, is it irregular, is it one time or seasonal? So that people really track actual. We throw out the monthly budget. We think the monthly budget only works for some people. It works for those that check their stuff all the time, that know how to move their bills around, that have got emergency savings, savings for irregular bills, that have a partner that they can work with where they're not at odds, and that have an accountability system in place so that when the temptation comes to spend it here, when I committed to spend it there, I kind of regulate myself. That's when a monthly budget works. A monthly budget also works when it's automated. So your paycheck comes in and it gets divvied out for all these things, and then, you know, life doesn't happen. You just keep going. And there's no emergencies, there's no crisis, there's no, you know, anything. Now, that's not very many people in our world. So we go with actual. We go with what really comes in, what really goes out, and when. So that's the income and resource tracker. There's also a tool in here that helps people understand how they get paid. Because a lot of people, believe it or not, are paid on the cash system. Some people get a paycheck. They actually take a paycheck and they go and get it cashed, either at the check cashing place or at a bank. A lot of people have direct deposit. Some people have payroll cards because they don't bank. They don't have a bank account. The question is, what happens to the pay when the payroll card gets lost? And we encourage everybody to work with their HR departments. What's the backup if the card gets lost? And an electronic benefit transfer, EBT, you and I know what that is, but that's like the money that gets deposited into an account from a public benefit, right? So there's a lot of ways people receive their income and benefits, and this tool helps people to understand the benefits and the risks of each one, and a tip that you can use with your clients. Then there's ways to receive income and resources legally. And this is holding a garage sale, selling items online, claiming tax credits, getting a raise, changing the tax withholding, getting a part-time job, renting out a home in a house, doing an Uber, you know, a lot of ways. This goes on for 3 pages. And a lot of people will use this in a group setting. And they'll say, okay, this is what the CFPB says. What do you say? How else do people in our community make a little extra money? And I know a mom who knows how to play a guitar, and there's a lot of birthday parties, and she charges 10 bucks for every birthday party, and she brings in extra money that way. I knew another mother in Texas who made better tortillas in the tortilla company, and she made her tortillas and sold them in the neighborhood, right? That's how she made her money. And I laugh when I teach like this, because I'll use this example a lot, and I'll say, I never said the Department of Health came in and approved it, right? But that's how she does it, right? And so that's that. So we tracked what comes in. Now we're going to look at what goes out. And spending is really a touchy subject, really touchy, because we spend according to our needs, the things that we've got to have, according to our wants, the things we could survive without, think of camping, and according to our obligations, the things that we have to pay or we get in big trouble, like child support, like the loan on a car. If we don't pay it, they'll take the car. Like a school loan, they'll garnish our wages. those kinds of things. You know, these are obligations that we sign a contract for. So we're going to do a quick exercise here, and I'm going to write down a cell phone with a data plan. I want you to tell me, is that a need, a want, or an obligation? A cell phone with a data plan, is that a need, a want, or an obligation? A want, an obligation, a want. Heather says it's an obligation. Good for you, Heather. Everybody else says it's a want. Does anybody say it's likely an obligation if you signed a contract? Depends, Julie says. Lauren says, a need if you're looking for jobs and you don't have a computer access to the library, okay? All right, beautiful. I'm going to put in pet food. Is pet food a need, a want, or an obligation? Pet food. It's a want, obligation, want. Keep going, guys. There's 164 of us, which is fantastic. Want, obligation, need. My pets are my family. Obligation, okay, beautiful. You guys are doing great. You're doing great. I'm going to put down Jordan shoes. Is Jordan shoes a need, a want, or an obligation? A lot of people are saying it's a want. A want for status, want. Because regular shoes are needs, a want. Oh, you guys are all in agreement. Jordan shoes are a want. Okay, so here's what I want to go back to. Let's see. A want, you can usually get them cheaper if you know where to go, Lauren says. Okay, good. All right, so here's the thing I want you to think about. Let's go with the cell phone with a data plan. You guys each came up with good reasons for why for some it would be a want, for others it would be a need, and for others it would be an obligation. The need was, if I'm looking for a job and I'm far away from a library and I don't have access to the internet. Now that's a really, really good reason for a cell phone with a data plan. Another reason might be I heard of a mom who was in a different state and she had two disabled children. And the only way she could work was to have a cell phone with a data plan so that the caregivers could do, she traveled in her car for her job, could get a hold of her because of those disabled children. Otherwise, she would be unemployed. So that for her, it was an absolute need. I use the hotshot for my DJ business music. Okay, a hotspot, good. Somebody says connection to services if they have no transportation, it's a need, okay? So you can see that for some people it's a real need, other people it's a want. Maybe the phone itself, but the data plan is a want, and for others it's an obligation because they signed a contract. I saw a lot of people on pet food say it's a need, a want, an obligation. Some said it was an obligation. If I have a pet, I got to feed him, it, him, her. Others said it's a real want. Pet food, they could eat off the table, or you just don't have an animal. And others, it's a need because that pet is my family, a real family. I mean, that pet dies, I go through grief just like everybody else who has a loss in life, right? And you look at a service dog for someone who's blind. I work with people who are blind, and they have service dogs. Boy, when that dog dies, I'm telling you, it is like losing a brother or a sister or a parent, a family member. And then when you get to Jordan shoes, you guys all said they were wants, but if I lived in Chicago, I had people tell me that it was an absolute need because they didn't want their kid to get killed with the gangs, that they had to have it to fit in. So there's a lot of different reasons why people have needs and wants and obligations. And again, if you and I are sitting across the table from somebody, our job is to have them. They have to figure out their needs, wants, and obligations. Why? Because this forms the spending plan. And you and I need to do the same thing. Our spending plan goes with our needs and our obligations and our wants. And it's really important we really prioritize this. And it's different if I'm a teenager than if I'm in my 20s and still single, than if I'm in my 30s and married or partnered, than if I'm in my 30s and there are children, than in my 40s and the kids are going to school, 50s or 60s, I'm an empty nester, 70s, I'm an elder, 80s, I'm a real elder, and then it's over. It's all over. And so all of this changes for us in life. So every year we encourage people to take a real hard conversation with themselves. What are my needs today? What are my wants today? What are my obligations today? Now, how do I take the resources that I've got and prioritize my needs, my obligations, and my wants? And the thing, the way we do this is you can help people with a spending tracker. They can track how they spend during a month or a week. That's a really good exercise. And they can say to themselves, this is the spending I can't cut because it's a need, because it's an obligation. This is the spending that could be eliminated. It's probably a want. And this is the spending that could be reduced. It could be any of them, right? This is a bill calendar. Some people use a monthly calendar in the kitchen. They simply write down when their bills are. Remember, this whole section is where money goes. And so you track it by putting the bills in the calendar for every month and, you know, erasing and moving around. Then there are strategies to cut expenses. Strategies like, can I bundle my television, my cable, and my phone? If I'm on a public benefit, could I get a free phone service? Can I unplug the utilities in my house, unplug, and only use what I need, except, of course, the refrigerator and the hot water heater? Hyacinth has heard this, and some of you too, but I was working with a group, and one attorney, I'm sorry, she was a banker in a state, simply unplugged the utilities of the wall, and she kept on the hot water heater and the refrigerator. She went from $153 one month to $26 the next, just by unplugging. What about sharing costs? Like, I know people in my state who will buy, they're not vegetarian, they'll buy a quarter of a cow together, or they buy supplies together, or they share their lawnmowers. You know, all kinds of things that people do, right? There are, I want to skip that. Prioritizing bills is really important because a lot of people are afraid that when the debt collector calls, they've got to pay the debt collector what the debt collector says. Ooh, I see something here. Get a dumb phone for calls. Have them figure out their needs, their wants, their obligations. That's a half of a half. Chris, tell me what you mean by that. I don't know what that means. That's one half of a one half and a smile. So if you can help me out here. But anyway, in paying prioritizing bills, this is what the CFPB says. Protect your income. Protect your shelter. Pay your obligations. Protect your assets. So what do they mean by protect your income? If you need a car to get to work, stay current on your car payment and your insurance. If in protecting your shelter, oh, half-half, oh, I see, a quarter beef, got it. Thank you, Chris. Oh, that's a technical description for a quarter beef, half-half. Oh, thank you very much, I just learned something, great. Protect your shelter. Whether you have a mortgage, the cost of losing your home is big. Remember to include your taxes and your condo fees, your mobile home fees, et cetera, and pay your obligations, child support, income taxes, student loans, and then protect your assets. Don't let your essential insurances drop. Your auto insurance, for example. Now, the CFPB says you got to pay your bills, but it says make sure you prioritize your bills and negotiate your bills and make sure you can, you know, cover these things at a minimum, okay? Now we're going to talk about getting through the month with a cash flow budget. And I want to show this to you. Okay. One of your colleagues says, can a bill collector demand you pay a certain amount and then try to garnish you if the amount you said wasn't to their liking? We're going to get to that in a minute. I'm going to hold on to that and get it to the debt section, and then we'll tackle it, okay? Thank you for asking that, and It's a complicated answer, so I want to tackle it when we get to debt. So this family's got $37 when they begin the week, and they end the week with $122. They started with $37, they end the week with $122. Now, look at the left-hand side here for a second. The income from a job, SNAP, and a public housing voucher, they put in all resources, and the income from a job, look at, it's a regular job but irregular pay. Week one, they have $305, week two, $290. SNAP, that's only, you know, a benefit card, $280, it comes in the first week. A public housing voucher goes right to the landlord, but $650, right? Now look at, you add all that up, and it comes to $1,272. Now look at the left-hand side. They started with their needs, savings for emergencies, housing, utilities, groceries. Then we might be getting to a want, but you notice that it's zero. Transportation and needs. So they spend their whole spending, they prioritize their topics according to their needs. They add up the bills. The first week the bill was $1,149. They subtract all their bills from what they brought in and they ended up in the positive. And you can see that. So then what happens is they carry the positive into the next week. And that's $122 and they end up again in the positive, $157. Now look at week two, $290, that's all they've got, but they add that to the $122 and they've got $413 to work with. Now look at the savings, housing, there was nothing, utilities, look at the utilities, the first week it was $59, the second week it was $95. They're probably paying a utility bill in the second week that's different than the first, we don't know what it is. Food, they paid more food the first week than the second week. Transportation, more the first week, maybe their insurance was due, and then gas, I don't know. But you can see that they add up actually what they pay out compared to what they bring in to see if they're in the black or in the red. Now this is Raphael, he's a single dad, he's late with his payments because he doesn't have the money when he needs it. He tracked his spending with a USDA Cooperative Extension educator, and now he uses cash flow. And this is, I want you just to bear with me for a second. This is a bit of a, I hate this chart, and I know you do too. But here's week one. Week one, they start in the black, 257. Week two, he starts in the negative, 361. Week three, he starts in the black, 65. Week four, he starts in the negative, 436. Now look at the end of week one. At the end of week one, he ends with a negative 361, and that's what's carried over. And then he ends with the 65, and that's what's carried over into week three. And he ends with the 463, and that's what's carried over to week four. And then he ends with a 361. Now look at the left-hand side. He's got a job and a part-time job, and he's got SNAP. And when you look at, let's say it's in November, he gets paid on the second and the fourth week in November. This is his net. So he puts $990 in week two and $990 in week four. Then he has a second job. He's got a regular job and regular income, $220 every single week. Maybe he's a guard somewhere, I don't know, security guard. SNAP, he gets it in the first month. You know, this is the benefit he gets for three people where he lives. All right, so then you add in week one, the 257 plus the 220 plus the 412, and you come to 889. Then you start to lay out all of his payments. So he has nothing for savings. Housing, he pays 845, and that's his rent and utilities. And then it goes down to groceries, 200, eating out, 25, fuel, 60, childcare, 70, miscellaneous, 50. When you add up all his bills, it comes to $1,250. When you subtract that from what he brings in, he's in the hole. We don't want that because he's carrying the negative over, and that already takes away from anything he's bringing in, so he's only got $849 to work with. Then he's got all these other costs, a student loan, television, supplies, groceries, transportation, car payments, oops, he didn't have a car payment. He's got fuel, auto insurance, that's a lot. You know, child care, it's a lot. That's not a lot. It's actually a little, but he has $70 every week for child care, and his miscellaneous is $50 every week. Go to the third week on his spending. He's got a credit card payment of 90, and then it jumps down to internet, 22, household supplies, 86. So you can see that the question is, what can he do to better match the timing? And the answer is, he can move all his bills around. He calls his credit card company and moves his bill to when he's got money coming in. He looks at his student loan and says, I think I could get into an income-based repayment and reduce his student loan and pay his student loan when he's got the money. He could do something around food. Maybe he buys in bulk. We're not judging that he pays more in food. Look at what he's paying in food, $200, $300, $380. $460 in food, and yet he brings in $412 in SNAP. Is it wrong? No, of course not. Maybe he's got special needs kids. Maybe they have a lot of family gatherings. I don't know. But the bottom line is maybe there's something different he can do in food so that he buys in bulk or he reduces his cost, and he does it when he's got money. So he could talk to his landlord. He could try to pay twice a month instead of once a month. And here's the thing about this. If you add up all the money he brings in and you add up all the money that goes out, he is in the positive. And so the idea here, SNAP is intended to be a supplement. It's not intended to cover the full cost of food, so he should definitely be spending more than $412 a month on food. Thank you, Lauren. Absolutely, of course. Okay, so the main thing on his scenario, look at, he's a single dad. There's no child support coming in. There's no earned income tax credit coming in. There's no state tax credit coming in. There's no public housing voucher coming in. There's no CHIP for helping the kids. There's no, if the wife or spouse is dead, there's no disability income coming in, right? So there's a lot more he can do on the income and resource side. And so you want to work with somebody so that, I want to just show this to you a second. He increased his cash and income and resources. He decreases what he spends, and he moves things around so he can better match the timing. And then basically the two tools you'll use is, this goes on for three pages. Weeks 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you'd have one of these for every month. January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, and then they put down what the actual income is and the actual carryover is, the balance from the week before, on everything, even all the public benefits. And the same is true. Look at on the left-hand side. It starts with obligations, credit card payments, payday loans, personal loans, and then it'll go to needs and then to wants. So there's a lot that people can do to better match the timing of what comes in and what comes out. Some people hate charts. And I respect that. So instead of a chart, use a calendar. And I want you to look at this week in the calendar and use the monthly calendar. The month works better than the week. Because look at Sunday the 16th, up and down, Monday the 17th, up and down, Tuesday the 18th, up and down, etc. All you do is you take a line from the left-hand side and go all the way through to the right. On top, you put in all the income and resources that come in, and on the bottom, you put in all the bills that get paid. So on the top, this person brings in SNAP, $280, and then on Saturday gets paid, $305. When you add that together, that's $585. Underneath it all, on Monday, he or she bought food and paid a phone bill. On Thursday, they bought gas for the car. On Saturday, there was a car payment of $180. When you add all that together, $450, and subtract it from the $585, you come up with $130. This is a good week. But some weeks are in the negative. So you have to move the bills around and renegotiate and bring in other resources. And a lot of people will have these calendars. There's ketchup on the calendar and peanut butter on the calendar, and there's a pencil and colored markers. I know in North Carolina, she works with foster youth, and she color codes everything. Everything on the top that comes in is green. All the bills are either red or yellow. The red are the ones she's already paid, and the yellow are the ones she has to pay. And then when it's paid, she'll put a big check mark through it, and she just uses a calendar to kind of move things around and calls the creditors. You know, the creditors will change the dates. They want to get paid. And the landlords often, not always, will do the 1st and 15th because it's cheaper to keep somebody, all right? So there's a whole strategy for how to improve, negotiate due dates, negotiate splitting payments, avoid large lump sums. There's all kinds of ideas. This goes on for 3 pages. All right, so that's cash flow. Now we're going to quickly do debt and credit. So debt is a drag. Debt is money that we owe. It's a liability, and it obligates future income. Debt is different than credit. Credit's the ability to borrow and create debt. Debt is when we've borrowed. That's basically how it works, okay? So we're not going to do this exercise, but we want everybody to be really careful of the rent-to-own arrangements, rent-to-own your refrigerator, rent-to-own your couch, rent-to-own your this or your that, because of the costs and the fees. We're not saying don't do it. We're just saying make sure people understand the terms. Make sure people understand what it means to co-sign on a loan, that they are obligated, that their student loans that they co-sign, the credit cards they co-sign, they're obligated for all that stuff. And on medical debt, make sure to try to get the medical debt costs up front. Medical debt is still a major factor in bankruptcies. And so really working with them to get the costs up front so that you know, does the insurance cover it or not? What are the copays going to be? What are the deductibles going to be? Do I have a health savings account or not? And make sure to get this stuff up front. Okay, so what we do then is the tools, and be careful of debt settlement services. There's a lot of promises and a lot of scams. Some of them are fine, a lot of them aren't. Let me get to the tools, and they all go together. The first tool is tracking the debt. What do I owe? Who do I owe? What's the interest rate? What's the payment, et cetera? The next tool is how much debt is too much debt. I figure out my debt-to-income ratio, and I help the clients I work with do the same. And it's really an easy calculation. You take your monthly debts. So I would take, this isn't true about me, but if it was, I would take the credit card debt, number one, credit card debt, number two, school loan payment, car loan payment, mortgage payment, whatever the minimum payments are, and I would add those together. Debts, real debts, not expenses, debts. Then I divide that by my gross income every month. What's the, not the net, but the gross that I bring in at my paychecks every month? And then I'm going to come up with a ratio. So I take the debt, I divide it by the gross, and I come up with the ratio. If the ratio is under 0.20 or 20%, you know, that's good. That's a guideline, meaning take a dollar bill and just less than a quarter of it, just cut it debt. If I'm a homeowner and it's just my, you know, mortgage and taxes and insurance principal, I should be ideally at a 0.28 or 28% or 28 cents of the dollar. So you take a dollar bill, a quarter of it, just over a quarter of it, cut it off. I should be under that. If I put all my debt together, it should be under a 0.36 or 36%, or take a dollar bill, a third of it is 33%, just cut it off. So the idea here is that if I have too much debt, you know, like this is a family that's got a 0.50 in debt, that means 50 cents of every dollar goes to debt. That means they've only got 50 cents for everything else, a real drag. So then we want to think about reducing debt. And I want you to think about debt in two different ways. There's debt that helps us get ahead in life, and there's debt that keeps us behind. Can anybody give an example of debt that helps us get ahead? What's an example of debt that helps us get ahead? Home ownership. So somebody owns a home, going to school, having a mortgage, a school loan. Those are great examples. Okay, what is a debt that keeps us behind? Like it's just really hard to get ahead. A debt that keeps us behind, credit cards, medical bills, a shopping cart, credit cards. Okay, you guys are onto it. So the higher interest rate method and the snowball method are two different ways to reduce debt. I'm just gonna give you a quick example. If I've got a credit card and I owe $500, and then I've got another credit card and I owe $600, I would pay off the $500 first. That's a snowball method. And I would take the payment for the $500 because it's the lowest amount owed of all my debt. I would pay that one off first, and then I would use the minimum monthly payment, and I would add that to the $600 credit card and pay that off faster. That's what a snowball is. It catches snow and it goes down the hill faster if it's not wet. Okay? The higher interest rate method is that, let's say I got a credit card of $500 and I'm paying 29%, and I've got a credit card of $600 and I'm paying, 9%. Well, I'm going to pay off the credit card of 29% first because of all the fees and the compounded interest. I'd pay that one off first, even no matter what the terms are. A lot of people like the snowball method better, but people use both methods and people combine methods. There's a great tool on paying student loans. There's a lot of ways to pay student loans now, and it's got a rate discussion in there on it. Income-based repayment is a great way to go. People work for a nonprofit, graduated payments. There's a great student loan deal on the website. The debt collector, here's the thing on debt collectors. There are new rules now on debt collectors. The pressure is on the debt collector to prove that the debt is actually owed. So a lot of debt is sold or passed on, and the debt isn't actually owed. I just ran into a gentleman Maryland, maybe about 3 weeks ago now, and he's probably in his early 70s. He had paid off his student loans 40 years ago. He's got a debt collector coming after him for student loan payments that he had already paid off. They're not his, and he doesn't know what to do. So the thing you want to do is you want to make sure the debt is actually owed, and the way it's done is there are letters that you can use with your clients that the onus is on them to prove that the debt is there. So they have to send in the letter and have the proof come that the debt is theirs. There's new rules now that there's no obscene phone calls, no threats, no publishing of lists, no false or deceptive, and they need to be turned in. And we'll get to that in a second. So you've got to really know your rights. And here's what's really hard about the question that came earlier. Can they garnish wages? Can they charge fees and fines? And I think the question in the beginning was, what was that question? How did that go? I promised we would handle it here, and I can't find it. Can they still hurt you?
I'm going to send it to you in just a second so you have the exact quote.
Thank you very much, Hyacinth. I need your help. Anyway, the bottom line is the Behind on Bills that is on the website has a really robust visual checklist around debt collectors, and I can't tell you enough about how much you should get this and make a copy of it, because it shows visually, make sure it's yours. Verify the debt. Ask the debt collector the dates, the amount, the creditors, when the last payment was. They have to prove all that stuff. If the court has sent notice, respond to the court. Don't pretend it's the, you know, because if the court doesn't hear back, they assume that the you and I, the consumer, is wrong. So you got to really respond to the court requests and make sure they know you're in a process of verifying the debt, because you don't remember the debt, or your client doesn't remember the debt, or the debt didn't belong to them, it belonged to the spouse, you know, all those things that happen. The debt collectors can cause harm for sure, so you can't avoid them. That's a lot of people just don't answer the phone, right? That's not right either. The debt has to be proven first, that the debt is really theirs. And the way this works is that in most cases, there will not, should not be charges, there should not be any action taken when somebody's in the process of trying to figure this out. But I'm going to really refer this to the credit and debt counselors that are in your area through the National Foundation of Credit Counselors. Look them up, and they have 800 numbers, and you can have your clients go directly to them, and they're very much trained on how to deal with, do they have to provide the original debt documents? Yes, they do. Can a bill collector demand that you pay a certain amount and then try to garnish you? No, the debt collectors don't do the garnishing. So this is why it's really important for all these specific questions to really work with the credit and debt counselors that are trained and certified through the National Foundation of Credit Counselors. That's, I've got to really make this referral at this point, because the debt collectors will threaten, but they can't do it, no matter what they say, okay? Now, credit is really important. We're going to run out of time here, so I want to quickly go to credit. You guys know how important credit is. It keeps us, you know, the employers look at it, landlords, insurance companies, credit card companies, utility companies. And in a credit report, I think a lot of you know how to read a credit report, but some of you don't. There's buckets of information. Who am I? What's the public information out there, public record information? What's the collection agency account information? What's the credit account, and what are the inquiries made to the account? Negative information stays on for 7 years for most items. A bankruptcy stays on for 10 years. A civil suit and a judgment usually is 7 years, and there's no length of time for good stuff to stay on, okay? All right. We want everybody to get their credit report at annualcreditreport.com and to avoid all ads. And you want to get 3 credit reports, one from TransUnion, one from Equifax, and one from Experian. The questions that they ask to prove your identity, you may not have the answers, and if you don't, just have them send it. They may ask what your first car was and you don't remember. They may ask if you've got a credit card in this bank account. You might not remember the bank, but you remember the credit card. You know, stuff like that. Okay, so this is where you get your free credit report, and this is the FICO score. So a lot of scores out there are what we call education scores. They're not exact. The banks will use certain scores if you're going to apply for a mortgage. This is a FICO score that the CFPB says is good and you can count on it, but it costs money to get it. So if you look at the green and the blue green, the 65%, if you add that together, that's what counts for the score. The green is making my payments on time. The blue green is how much I owe against what I'm allowed to take out. So if I've got a Home Depot card and they allow me to take out $1,000, if I only take out 30% or less of what I'm allowed, that's the fastest way to increase the score. I make the payments on time, I borrow 30% or less of what I'm allowed. The rest of this stuff, the length of credit history, getting new credit, having types of credit, that all adds to the score. But the biggest part is the green and the blue-green, okay? All right, I'm just going to skip over that for a minute. You guys will get all these slides through Hyasynth. So this is the tool. You get the credit report, then you use the credit report checklist. Is your name correct? Your social security number, et cetera. If it's not correct, you have to file a dispute with each one in writing. Some of them will allow you to do it online. Some of them want letters. If you are not getting an answer, submit a complaint to the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau because you need to get your credit reports fixed. And this is how you improve your credit report and your score. And that's a whole, this goes on for 2.5 pages. Records are really important. They create a paper trail. A lot of people don't keep their financial records and the databases. Let me give you an example. I was working with somebody and they were trying to get their birth certificate. Now that's not a financial record, but it's a record. The hospital was sold to a regional hospital and all the data files were transferred and very difficult to get. So even though people say they've got everything on a data file, they may for the next 40 years of your life, but we don't know what's going to happen to all that stuff. So we encourage everybody to keep these records, pay stubs, bank records, you know, your debt agreements, your insurance documents, because when it comes up and you've got to verify something or prove that the school loan you paid 40 years ago is actually paid, that you've got the records for it. Money services, accounts, and loans, the most important thing here is that money is now dealt with in all these ways, department stores, automobile dealers, superstores, check cashers, blah, 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 all this stuff, right? And in the olden day, you used to just go to the bank or the post office to get a money order. No longer. So this particular tool helps people to understand what they need. I want a safe and secure place to keep my money. I want to be able to make purchases without carrying cash, et cetera. And then it shows where they go to get it. I can get, you know, I want to be able to get a small loan quickly without hassle. I could get it with a credit card, a pawn shop, a finance company, or a payday lender. Nobody says they're good or bad, but it just educates people where they get all this stuff. And then there's another tool that goes over the pros and the cons, the risks and the benefits. So this is on Money Basics, this tool or worksheet. And, you know, some people just don't know what a checking account is or a prepaid debit card or a money transfer or a bill payment service or a savings account or a line of credit or a car title loan or online banking. And the tool itself, a lot of people use it in groups or one-on-one where you can actually get the definition of what it is and what the pros and the cons are because ideally, we're going for empowerment, what works for this family at this time in their lives, right? And then there's a tool on what do I need to open an account? Well, I got to have some money. Well, I have to prove who I am. I do not have to have a Social Security number. I could have an ITIN number. I don't have to be a citizen to open up a bank account. And it goes through all the things you need to open it up. I've got it or I need it to open up an account. Overdrafts, people get really burned with overdraft fees. What are they? Money transfers, there's new rules now. The exchange rate, the fees, the charges, all that stuff has to be up front. And the rules are now, and the CFPB was instrumental in this, that you need to know what the other person is going to receive on the other end. So that's important because a lot of our people transfer money. Protecting money, if you want to submit a complaint to the CFPB, it's a really easy thing to do. I did it as a volunteer not that long ago with someone, and she was able to get a response within about 9 days. This was on a freeze she did in her credit file because of an identity theft. And so it goes through. It asks you what's the issue about. Is it a mortgage, a payday loan, a student loan, a credit card company? What is it? And then you go through and you answer, and I want to encourage you to do this one file complaint for one topic. You can't mix topics because they won't know what to do. But maybe this was on a checking account or a fee or something like that. I'll tell you a good one. A Head Start dad in Florida called and said, I'm getting fees on my checking account in anticipation of my check coming through and me not being able to pay my bills on time. He was getting charged for overdrafts when there were no overdrafts, and he couldn't get it resolved. So he submitted a complaint to the CFPB, and then they went to the bank. So you know, this was a Head Start dad who chaired the policy council in Florida, right? He had it. He wasn't overdrafted or anything like that, but he was getting these fees, and part of it is because of the technology being used in that particular bank. All right, so the complaint process, it's submitted, it's routed, and it's done electronically, and it's all public. So you can go into the database and put in your zip code, and you can find out all the complaints that are coming up in your area. Just try it sometime. And I'll tell you, the banks will clean things up pretty fast because they don't want that negative information out there. Protecting your identity, this is all the stuff that is our identity, and this is a checklist. Do not opt out. These are opt out, do not call lists. This goes on for 3 pages of all the things to do to protect your identity. On the front end, if an identity has been stolen, we are encouraging anybody to go into identitytheft.gov. When the identity has already been stolen, go to www.identitytheft.gov, and that will give some really good directions of what to do after the identity has been stolen. Okay? Red flags. Help everybody understand their red flags. If there are pressure tactics, if they won't put it in writing, if there's unexplained fees, et cetera, listen to their gut. Avoid all the red flags. Consumer protection. This particular toolkit has all the consumer laws. And for fun of it, you could give a law to every, you know, you could take a law every week in your staff meeting and look at the law and just know how it's supposed to be followed in your communities and give an example of how it's being followed and how it's not being followed. And you'll be really smart in consumer protection. And then finally, we've got 4 minutes left. These are the resources. Go to consumerfinance.gov. Do you see down there the National Foundation for Credit Counseling? That is your go-to friend on all these really intense credit and debt issues. Debt collectors, all that stuff, those guys know what they're doing, and the CFPB stands behind them, okay? All right, so could you guys, the 153 of us that are here, we had 166, could you jot down a key takeaway that you're taking from this training today, a key takeaway that you actually are going to use with your clients? Could you use the chat function, a key takeaway from today's training that you're actually going to use with your clients? Okay, the resources, Melinda says, I'm going to use the resources. I'm going to use the income and resource tracker. I'm going to use the monthly bill tracker. I'm going to use the tracking of spending tool, okay? I'm going to switch to talking about cash flow rather than monthly budget. It's going so fast, I can't read it all. God, Hyacinth, isn't this wonderful? I'm going to use the credit counseling. We need to educate clients and financialists, discuss money, protective factors. I'm going to use the bill calendar and working on the budget. Good job, everybody. Good job. How to get a credit report. Discuss and emphasize active methods to help clients not be frozen on their own credit scores. Good job. Good job. Okay. Is there anything else you want to learn about? Is there anything else you want to learn about in this area? And I can give the feedback to the CFPB. Is there anything else you want to learn more about? Definitely, I'm going to learn the laws. I got to learn those laws. Yep. What else do I want to learn more about? Saving for retirement at an early age, good. Dispute letters, good. They're all there. Consumer rights, good. Okay, consumer rights, good.
And
what
I got
else?
Some other ones that were sent just to me that
what
I can
got?
Share as well.
What do you got, Hyacinth?
Sure. So some other people said different types of bankruptcy. Oh, it's going faster than me too. Different types of bankruptcy and scores. More information on wage garnishment. Someone else said, a need to train our Head Start in-home personnel on how to bring up the topic of money with their family.
Good. What were the other ones that we saw? The difference between the CFPB and the Better Business Bureau. I can do that quickly. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, was started with Elizabeth Warren basically after the crash, and they really go into enforcing banks and credit card companies, educating consumers. The Better Business Bureau really tracks if a business is legit and is following the rules, the business side. The consumer side is just the ordinary people like you and I. They want to make it safe in the marketplace. So they're not the same at all. You want more in credit reports, and can debt be re-something? What does Michelle say? Renegotiated, I think is what. Yes, debt can be renegotiated. Definitely it can be renegotiated. Budgets for SSI and welfare recipients. Let me just say to you, Dolores, and to others, the cash flow method I shared with you can be used for people only on SSI, SSDI, and welfare, and no cash, because it's all a resource that comes in and money that goes out, and we want people on public benefits to use it. A lot of people in the country are using this only on public benefits. We have people coming out of prison, all they're on is public benefits. That's all they've got. So we teach this method because once they get cash and once they start to replace those public benefits, they'll know what the costs are. But some people will be on disability forever, and that's okay. You know, that just is what it is. So they can still make ends meet. And I highly encourage the disability, the focus on persons with disability. We just hit the top of the hour, and this was our training. And I just can't thank you enough for being here. Thumbs up or thumbs down, thumbs neutral. Oh, can you help me out? Hyacinth, I lost it. Thumbs up or thumbs neutral for the training today? Thumbs up or thumbs neutral? Thumbs up or thumbs neutral? Okay, awesome training. Thumbs up, thumbs up. Thumbs up or thumbs neutral? Loved it. Very helpful. Thumbs up, thumbs up. Thumbs up. It's all we could do in 2 hours. Thumbs up, thumbs up. Good job. Thumbs up. You guys are amazing. Keep up the great work out there. Very best wishes to each of you in the CAP world. Remember, the 1964 Economic Opportunity Act, reducing poverty was about mobilizing resources to reduce poverty, and that's what this is. Bring this resource. And my thanks from the bottom of my heart to our friends in D.C. who helped put this thing on, Hyacinth, you in particular, okay?
Thank you, Denise. We're so happy to, again, continue the spread of this great, great resources and everything else available through CFPB out to our network and then trickling down to our families. So thank you so much for your time today.
Beautiful. Good luck, everybody. Bye-bye now.
All right. Thank you, Denise. So before those of you start hanging up on the phone, I just want to advertise some additional related events that are going to be made available through the Learning Communities Resource Center. Again, I want to thank you all so much for your time in participating in today's event. I hope that all of you were able to gain something out of it and are going to go out and download this toolkit and start using it with your families. I shared in the chat where you can find this on CFPB's website, but that information, in addition to a copy of the slides and the recording link, will be shared with everyone who registered for today's event. So if you're here, don't worry about it. You're going to get a copy of the slides, all of the related resources, and the recording link for today's event. So some other related webinars that we have that are coming up in the pipeline, we really want to feature our anti-poverty practice series. And this is where we highlight what was learned over the course of the last 2 years of the learning community, and we showcase it out to you in the network. And each of the webinar events in the series is actually accompanied by a case study, which highlights participants from each of these learning community groups and their lessons learned. So if you're interested in learning more about some of these specific topic areas that we looked at in the learning community and you want to get started at your own organization, you can take a look at these publications and register for these webinar events to learn more about what we did. So the first two have already happened. The next one that's going to take place is on the 16th, and that's when you can actually hear from community action agencies out in the field that participated in the learning community to hear about their experience and their lessons learned. But also, I want to highlight for you folks on the phone, specifically the event on December 4th, which deals with our financial empowerment for families learning community. And a central component of their work in that group was using the Your Money, Your Goals toolkit and working that into the different financial empowerment services that they were offering. So if you're interested in learning more about how this toolkit plays out on the agency level, highly recommend that you join us for that event or at least download the publication when it's released that same day. Also, if there are any state associations on the line with us today, we want to highlight some upcoming events that we have for you, particularly tomorrow, which is our Ready, Set, Go, a guide for facilitating a learning community. So if any of you on state level are interested in learning about how to host a learning cohort across your state or region, we encourage you to sign up for tomorrow's event, and there will also be an accompanying publication that you can download and use to get you started on building your own learning community. And we also have an event towards the end of this month on the 27th, which is specifically for state offices, and again, what you can do to facilitate your own learning community in your region. Finally, as a part of our racial equity work, we want to highlight some upcoming events that we have, specifically on the 29th. Which is going to be a racial equity resource review. So you can tune into that to see Tiffany Marley and myself review the resources that have been shared so far across the learning community and some more of what you can expect from us in the future. And we're very excited for this event on the 6th, which is going to be featuring Prosperity Now as a part of their work in this space, talking about the racial wealth divide and how that is dividing America's middle class. So we very much encourage you to join us for that event. Last but not least, I would certainly be remiss if I didn't thank the other members of our team who participate in this work and the training that was offered today. You can see all of our lovely faces there, and you can see all of our contact information here. So if you want to reach out to any of us with any questions on Your Money, Your Goals, or any of the other offerings that we have here at the partnership, please feel free to reach out to any and all of us, and we will do our best to get you connected. But with that, I appreciate all of your time, and that is going to conclude today's webinar event. Thank you all so much for joining us, and we hope to see you at our future webinar event. Thank you.